हाय स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू लर्न अबाउट द एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव सिस्टम एंड आर्किटेक्चर ड्यूरिंग द मेडिवल एज. व्हाट इज दिस एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव सिस्टम चिल्ड्रन? एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव सिस्टम रिफर्स टू सिस्टम्स एंड प्रोसेसेस फॉर फाइलिंग एंड रिकॉर्ड कीपिंग और द ऑफिस करस्पॉन्डेंस. एंड आर्किटेक्चर चिल्ड्रन, आर्किटेक्चर मीन्स the art or practice of designing and constructing buildings. So we are going to learn about today this both thing during the Rajput age.
Kasam Muse Love Dairo, a group of folk singers, was organized in the village square, and the entire village had gathered there at night. So if you have seen many a times, children, around, if any occasions are there, they keep a log dairo. Especially in the village, you can see this kind of log dairo, where the famous folk singers, they come and they sing about different things. For example, they sometimes they sing about the martyrs, they sing about the freedom fighters, they sing about the famous people or the Mahabharata or the Ramayana, like that thing they do during the Lok Dairo. Small children had already taken their position in the front row. Patriotic songs were also being sung at the Lok Dairo. Along with folk songs, utsav like the Palia recital. What is Palia recital, children? Songs sung in honor of the martyrs. Very much. The next day, he asked his grandfather, what does the Palia mean? His grandfather told him that a Palia is a memorial commemorating the hero. So a Palia, children, this is on the right hand side of your screen, you can see I have given the image of Palia, children. This is one kind of a monument, and giving respect to this monument, to remember this soldiers, the martyrs, they are singing this Lok Dairo. It is a tribute. Tribute means respect to the martyrs who have sacrificed their lives while protecting and ensuring the welfare of the people. So they have given, they shed their lives and bloods for the welfare of the people. These palias are worshipped during the festivals, and songs are sung as homage. Homage means as a respect to these martyrs. This is the culture of our country. Utsav and his friend requested his grandfather, grandfather, please enlighten. Enlighten means give more knowledge about the Indian culture. Wait, said grandpa. He went in and came back with some pictures. He then asked Utsav, can you see this temple? These temples, in these pictures, it seems as if these stones have their own stories to narrate, isn't it? So father is, grandpa is showing some temples, and he is trying to sell that there are plenty of stories behind these temples. Today I shall tell you about the civilization. A civilization means advancement and culture of the Rajput age, children. Here down I have given one more image of the time capsule, children. What is time capsule, children? A container storing a selection of objects chosen as being typical of the present time, buried for the discovery in the future. So this recently, which temple is constructed, children? The Ram temple in Ayodhya, isn't it? So when before they started construction, under 2000 feet something down, they have buried this capsule, time capsule, and in that everything, every few details, minor details of this temple or during this era's whatever things are there important, that is kept in this bottle, so that in future if there is any kind of complication, they can take it on and they can make it clear. Administrative system during the Rajput age. During the Rajput era, India was not ruled over by one king. India was divided into big and small states, and the extent of each kingdom depended on the king's military prowess. So as I told you, children, in the first chapter we learned that India, North Indian side, Harshvardhan was the powerful ruler, and in the South Indian side, Pulkeshi II was the powerful ruler. But later on, children, that power was given to the, it became a feudalism. Feudalism means Samanta Shahi. The landlords became powerful because the landlord used to collect the revenue for the land, and the sixth part of that revenue they used to give to the king, and with the remaining amount they used to train the military, they used to take the expenses of the military, and they used to give this military to the king for the battles. So slowly, slowly, this landlord, that is feudalism, they came into power, and this North India and South India, slowly, slowly, they started to divide into small, small parts. And earlier part we have learned about the different clans of the Rajput age, the Rajput dynasty, how they have shifted from north to south, and they have made their different kingdoms. Administrative system, after the 7th century, various dynasties ruled in India. However, even though different dynasties came to power, there was a little change in the administrative system. So children, after the 7th century, various Rajput dynasties ruled in India, but the administrative system remained same. Somewhere, somewhat, something was a little bit, there will be a changes, but the most of the part was same as the other part of the country. Though kingship was hereditary. Kingship means after the hereditary means children, after the father, the son only become the king. It was not compulsory that the eldest son would always automatically become the next king. So it was not at all necessary. If a king is having 7 children or 5 children, so he can make anyone. It is not necessary that the eldest son only should become the king. The heir apparent means children, a person legally entitled to a property. So a son or a daughter, he is the heir of the property. Apparent means understood. The heir apparent selected by the king was called the crown prince. So those whosoever was selected as a king, they were known as a crown prince. In some cases, even people and ministers elected or selected their king. So many of the time it was not necessary the king only has to select. Sometimes the ministers and the people also have selected their king. For example, while in Kashmir, King Yashaskara was selected and enthroned by the Brahmin groups. So King Yashaskara was selected. Maybe the king's son was not liable to become the king. So the Brahmin group has selected Yashaskara to become the king of the Kashmir. In Gujarat, Kumarpal was selected as the successor by the Council of Ministers. The ministers were appointed to assist the king to administer and manage the kingdom effectively. So, children, as I told you, when the kingdom became huge, it was very difficult for the king to manage everything. So what they used to do, they appoint the ministers and they appoint different officers to look after the different office. Yet at times people became victims of poor and wrong administrative policies. So it was not necessary that every time they chose the correct king. Sometimes, many a times it happens that the person whom they have elected or whom they have appointed, they were very disappointed with their works. So then kindly copy down this question answers. If it is there in the workbook, kindly copy down in the workbook. And if it is not there, you can copy down on a piece of paper. Administrative system in the villages. Now, how the administrative system worked in the villages. Village institutions were very important during the medieval period. The panchayat looked after its administration. Today also, children, we have gram panchayat, isn't it? Panchayat means what? Panch means 5, isn't it? So 5 people, they are the 5 leaders are there. They are known as the panch. The head of the panchayat was called Mukhi or Sarpanch. Sar means head of the panchayat. They are known as Sarpanch. And he was responsible for protecting and delivering justice to the villagers. His was the final word. So anything, any disputes occurs in the village, Sarpanch's word will be the final word. Still in many cases, the Gram Sabha would also give verdict. Verdict means final judgment and punish the culprits. Those who are doing any kind of wrong things, they are punished by them. Even today at the village level, the Gram Panchayat or the elders of the Panchayat provide guidelines to the people. At that time, land revenue was the main income of the kingdom. So when we learned about children in Harshvardhana's time, children, Nalanda University, how the Nalanda University was constructed, it was taken from the land revenue. From that land revenue, they made a huge university. So same was the condition. The main income what they was getting was from the land revenue. Each kingdom had different ways of collecting land revenue. But usually the 6th part of the cultivation was taken as the land revenue. Apart from this, other taxes were also levied on the people. So not only this land revenue, children, other taxes like recently, children, we are having water tax, isn't it? Land tax, education tax. So different tax were also imposed on the people. Different officers were appointed for different activities. Moreover, taxes were collected at ports. Ports, you know, no? Where ship and boats, they come and stand. That is harbor. That is known as ports. And octroi points, children. Octroi points, children, means a duty levied on various goods entering a town or a city. If you have seen Junagadh today in our city also, when you enter the city, there will be a octroi naka. And the truck and the lorry which is carrying goods from outside, they have to stand. There will be a weighing scale. And they have to stand, that truck has to stand on that, it has to be put on the weighing scale. And they will see how much quantity of things they are carrying inside. And according to that, they have to pay the tax. Landlords collected the tax and paid tribute to the king. So they, as a respect, they used to give to the king. Literature. Let us move on towards the literature. Children, what was the condition of literature? During the Rajput age, there was a lot of religious writing as well as literature of various kind. Not only religious, children, there are different stories also were written during that time. Scholars and education received great patronage. Patronage means support given by the king. Many literary works were composed in Sanskrit, Prakrit, Tamil, Kannada, Telugu, etc. The great Sanskrit poet Mugg composed the epic Shishupala Vadha. Children, as the title says, Shishupala. Shishupala is the name of a person and Vad, the killing. So it is this story describes about how Lord Krishna becomes furious because Lord Krishna has taken a vow that earlier that Shishupala can abuse him 100 times. But after 100 times, when he will cross that 100 times, Lord Krishna will definitely kill Shishupala. So this is the 100th time, and after that, Lord Krishna kills Shishupala. So this is known as, this is the story of the Shishupala Vadha. Similarly, another poet, Sri Harsha, wrote the epic Naishada Charita, which is about the story of Nal and Damayanti. This is a romantic story, children. Even songs by Radha and other gopis sung in praise of Lord Krishna were presented in a lyrical manner. The biography and achievements of the kings were also composed in a poetic manner. Hemachandracharya wrote Kumarpal Charit. Kumarpal Charit is about King Kumarpal, King of Gujarat, Kumarpal, and the grammar book Siddhemd Shabdanusashan, as the title indicates, the name of King Siddharaj. So on behalf of Siddharaj, he wrote a book, grammar book. The name was Siddhem. Siddhem means about Siddharaj, and Shabdanusashan. Shabd means children, word, and Anusashan means rule. So this was a grammar book, children. As the title indicates, the name of King Siddharaj Jai Singh and Hemachandracharya are associated with this book. This book was considered as important, so important that it was placed on an elephant during a procession in Patan. So children, you can see whenever a procession is carried in the olden times, if you see, the king used to sit on the elephant and the procession was carried forward. But this time the grammar book was kept on the elephant to give the respect to that book. Not only poetry but plays were also written during that time. Bhavbhuti wrote Uttaram Charita, while Pandit Narayan composed Hitopadesh and a collection of stories based on Panchatantra. So today if you see in the library, children, you will find different Panchatantra books and Hitopadesh. They are all moral giving stories. Either your school or a nearby library must be having books containing collections of stories or folk tales. Let us now do a reading activity. Children, this side it is given the name of the poet and author, and the other side is the work done by that poet and author. Try to learn by heart. Now moving on towards the architecture. Among the various construction during the Rajput age, temple construction is noteworthy. The Rajput kings were fond of constructing grand and artistic buildings. The architecture and sculpture of that time is evident. Evident means proof from the temple, forts, palaces. So from the different kinds of temples, you will come to know that how the Rajput kings, they were lovers. They were good in architecture. Among the temples, Khajuraho in Madhya Pradesh and the Puri temple of Lord Jagannath are famous for their architecture and sculpture. The Sun temple of Konark was also built during that time. You can see in the last picture, children, down on the right hand side, that is the Konark temple, children. It is in the form of a chariot, shaped like a chariot, driven by 7 horses. Among the other Sun temples of India, the Marthan temple of Kashmir and the Modera Sun temple of Gujarat are famous. A prominent feature of the Modera temple, prominent means the main feature of the Modera temple, is that the first rays of the sun fall directly on the idol. So that is the main feature of that sun temple. The Ellora caves of the Deccan have caves representing 3 religions, Hinduism, Buddhism and Jainism. One among these is the Grand Kailash Temple. The Elephanta Caves near Mumbai have a beautiful 3-faced sculpture of Lord Shiva. The Meenakshi Temple at Madurai is famous all over India. The temples of South India are especially well known for their imposing gateways called Gopurams. After hearing about the fame of such grand temples, many foreign invaders came to loot them. The magnificent Somnath Temple of Gujarat was attacked many times. So the Ellora Caves, children, they are made from the Deccan. They are on the south part of our country. And we have learned about the Malwa Plateau and the Deccan Plateau, children. This Malwa Plateau we have learned in the lesson number 7, the India physiography, isn't it? The plateaus, they are made up of rocks. And if you see this Ellora Caves, Kailash Temple and Elephant Caves, children, you can see this is made out of one rock. This is made out of one. They have cut that one rock and they have made all these things. And which religions? That is mainly for Hinduism, Buddhism and Jainism. And in the Kailash Temple, children, you can see three-faced sculpture. In the Elephant Caves. The Elephant Caves are having three-faced. You can see down, you can see the picture I have given. Three face of Lord Shiva is maintained. And the Gopurams, you can see down below to the Kailash Temple, you can see huge Gopurams. This kind of temples are built or constructed in the South India. And children, hearing all this kind of about the grand temples, many foreign invaders means one who wanted to attack, they wanted to loot the country and take away all that thing. Mohammad Ghazni, though the Rajput age is well known for its valor and so the construction of many beautiful and imposing buildings, many foreign invaders invaded India during this period. So after, as India became very famous around the world, because India was known as the golden bird, children. So the people from different country, they wanted to attack our country and they wanted to take away the gold from the country. Mohammad Ghazni, the Sultan of Ghazna, attacked India many times, 1000 CE and 1075 CE. So Mohammad Ghazni, he attacked India many times. In spite of facing problems during the attacks, he continued to plunder India with full force. So he had a lot of problems while coming from Ghazna. You can see on the map, children, where is Ghazna located. From there, he used to come to this end to loot the Somnath Temple. Though he was having a lot of problems, but he still tried to loot many of the gold. As you may be knowing, children, the Somnath Temple was fully covered with the gold. During one such attack, when Gujarat was under Bhimdev Solanki's rule, he plundered Somnath. Many people from Saurashtra and Gujarat joined Bhimdev Solanki and tried to protect Somnath but failed. So Mohammad Ghazni attacked 7 times on Gujarat and finally last 8th time he was successful to take away all the gold from Somnath temple. Prithviraj. The change of power at Delhi after the demise means death of Mohammad Ghazni, the leaders of Ghazna started vying for the throne. Vying means they started to fight with each other. However, the Rajput kings did not take advantage of this weakness. So the Rajput king did not take any kind of advantage. They did not want to take anything from there. Meanwhile, Shahabuddin Ghori established his strong rule in Ghazna and decided to attack India. So meanwhile, who came in power, children? The leaders of the Ghazna, they were fighting for the throne. But who took away the throne? At last, Shahabuddin Ghori took the throne and he decided to attack. His intention was not to loot, but establish his rule here. So he was not thinking to loot like how Mohammad Ghazni has attacked and looted the gold and then he went away. But Shahabuddin Ghori did not want to go, but he wanted to remain in India and he wanted to become the ruler of our country. Initially, he wasn't successful. He could not forget his defeat by Queen Naitha Devi of Anilwat Patan, and therefore he did not attack India for 12 years. So initially, he had tried many times to attack India, but he was badly defeated by Queen Naitha Devi of Anilwat Patan. And then he did not return back to India for 12 years. After 12 years, once again, he decided to attack India. And this time he was successful and he got captured Delhi. Prithviraj fought bravely but without any prior preparation or help from the other Rajput kings. With his defeat, the Rajput rule came to an end in Delhi. So Prithviraj was the last king of the Rajput era. He fought with them without any preparation or without anybody's help, and thus the Rajput rule came to an end and Shahabuddin Ghori became the ruler of the country. and extended his kingdom. After Shahabuddin, his slave, so after Shahabuddin died, his slave is known as, slave means children, Ghulam. Qutbuddin Aibak ascended the throne. He was known as the founder of the slave dynasty. With this, Rajput rule came to an end in Delhi. There was a change in the administration and society. What kind of changes took place and why? Think about questions like this. In place of valor and sacrifice, people started conspiring. Conspiring means children, they started to make plans jointly to commit an unlawful or harmful attack. The throne of Delhi was stained with blood. Stained means marked with blood. So the people started to fight among themselves for the throne. Activity children. Copy down this question answers. If it is in the workbook, directly copy down in the workbook. And if it is not, write on a paper and stick it in the textbook. Children, correct options are given with the white, slight blue, light blue color is there. That is the correct options. Things to know: gods, apsaras, dancers, soldiers, birds and animals, flowers and vines, landscape and geometrical designs were engraved on the monuments. So, monuments, as you see on the in the first slide, the Palia monument, children, that is monument. So, the people used to make this kind of drawing, this kind of architectural work on the monument. The temples of Gujarat in Girnar, Shankeshwar, Shatrunjay, Ambaji, Dwarka, Shamlaji, etc. are unique examples of artistic construction. So here we come to the end of the lesson, children. I hope you understood this lesson. We'll see you in the next video. Till then, goodbye.